Bam, it's true.
In this video, we're going to continue our discussion of Pythagorean Theorem, where we're finding the lengths of missing signs. These examples, I'm going to do three of them. The last two are somewhat closely related to each other. We're going to do a couple of examples that have some algebra involved, where one missing sign is not just a variable, but an algebraic expression. Here we have x minus 1. And, you know, just work through a couple if you happen to have some of these questions, maybe, say, in an Algebra 2 book. So we got x minus 1 as a leg, helping to make one of the right angles. We've got 3, again, helping to make this 90-degree right angle, and a hypotenuse of 3, square root of 5. So if we're going to find this value of x, and then the length of the side of this right triangle, we have to set up the Pythagorean Theorem. When we know two sides, we're missing the length of one side of the triangle, we can solve for the missing length of that triangle using Pythagorean Theorem. So we have a squared, or one of the legs squared, plus one of the other legs, or the other leg squared. So, you know, a squared plus b squared. Just make sure the two sides that help make the right angle are together on the same side of the equation. So x minus 1 squared equals, and then parentheses, 3 square root of 5. Again, you should make sure that you always use parentheses when doing substitution into an algebraic equation or expression. So we have 3 squared, which is 9. And then we have x minus 1 squared. Well, x minus 1 squared is going to be, let's see here, off to the side, x minus 1 squared is x minus 1 times x minus 1. We're going to distribute that together. Make sure that you do that, because a lot of students will try and shortcut this process and end up with only two terms when they're supposed to be three. So x times x is x squared, x times negative 1 is negative 1x, and then another negative 1x, and then finally negative 1 times negative 1 is positive 1. So we have x squared minus 2x plus 1. So that's what we have here. So we have 9 plus, and then x squared minus 2x plus 1. And then, make sure this is looking all right. Yep. And then we have on the other side, you know, how do you take 3 square root of 5 and square it? Well, 3 square root of 5 is, well, when you square it, when you multiply it by itself, you do want to take those, sort of the coefficient of the radical, which is the 3, and multiply them together, because, well, it is squared. So 3 times 3 is 9, and the square root of 5 times the square root of 5 is the square root of 25, which is 5, and all of this is, touching, so all of that is being multiplied together. So don't do 9 plus 5 is 14 or something like that. This is all multiplied together, so 9 times 5 is equal to 45. Okay, so we have 9 and 1 make 10. We need to bring the 45 over to the left-hand side with subtraction. We're trying to solve for x, but I cannot isolate x because there's not just one x term, there's two. There's a square term and a single degree term. So we need to get this set equal to 0 and solve it with either factoring, completing the square, or the quadratic formula. So we're going to subtract both sides by 45 and get x squared minus 2x minus 35 equals 0. And when our leading coefficient is 1, we can kind of just pay attention to the constant. What factors of 35 subtract to give us a middle term of negative 2? See, factors of 35, there's not that many of them. What about 7 and 5? Now, it's a negative 35, so they need to be different, or have different signs. So we're going to have x, which is the factor. We're going to factor the first term and put those factors in the first two blanks. We're going to factor the constant and put those factors in the second, or the the second of the two blanks in these binomials, x squared is going to be x. And factors of 35 that subtract to be negative 2, we already talked about that 7 and 5. So the middle term is negative, so the larger of the two factors needs to be negative. So we're going to have minus 5, minus 7 and plus 5 equals 0. Now, after you've taken a quadratic, that's a power of 2, or a degree of 2, and factor it, then you set each factor equal to 0, because this is one clumping. The parentheses holds all this together, so this is something times something equals 0. And so one of those two factors has to be 0 so that the product is equal to 0. And, well, we're going to make that happen. They won't be both 0 at the same time, just as long as one of them are. So x minus 7 is equal to 0. X plus 5 is equal to 0. Set each one of those, or solve each one of those for x, and we get x is equal to 7, and x is equal to negative 5. Now, in pure algebra, there are two answers, but we are finding the lengths of a right triangle, and there is no such thing as a negative length. So while algebra gives us two possible answers, and if I gave you this question in an Algebra 1 or Algebra 2 class and said, solve it, there are two answers, we need to make sure that we use, you know, the solution, or maybe both work, I don't think they will, but we need to use the solution that gives us a reasonable answer over here in the fact that we are trying to find the sides of a right triangle. So we cannot use the x value of negative 5 because negative 5 minus 1 is negative 6 and you cannot have a negative length. So thus the answer that we can use is x equals 7. So we're going to take out the x, put in the fact that we just found it, that it equaled 7, and then 7 minus 1 is equal to 6. So not only do we know that x is equal to 7, but the side of this triangle, the leg, is equal to a length of 7 minus 1, which is 6. So we got two more examples. I'll be right back after I clean my board out. For our second example, we have a circle. We have a radius with a length of 300. We have a tangent line to the circle. It's a tangent line because it intersects once, and the line is perpendicular to the radius, so we know it's a tangent line. And we have a hypotenuse cut up in two different parts, and the only part that's labeled is the part extending outside the circle of 461.577. This could be some kind of sort of planetary word problem with a satellite. Could be some kind of like wheel or gear with, you know, a tangent line which represents a distance it traveled or something like that. I'm just giving you the diagram and we're going to figure out what x is equal to. Now, if you look at it and you go, well, let's see, Pythagorean theorem is when you only know two sides of a right triangle and you want to find the third missing side. And if you look at this and you initially go, well, I don't have all three sides. This is, the radius is 300, this length is unknown, and I just have the blue segment of 46.577 highlighted. I don't know what this little piece is. Well, it's a circle, right? So if you go from the center of a circle to a point on the circle, regardless of what direction you go in, you're using the radius. That is the radius. And the radius of a circle is a constant value. So this isn't really that difficult of a problem. My next example, which is going to look similar, will be a bit more thought-provoking. I can just recognize that other radius is also 300, and thus is just as straightforward as pretty much any other Pythagorean problem is, which is one leg squared plus the other leg squared is equal to the hypotenuse squared. Now, 461 is not the hypotenuse, nor is 300, but when you add them, you get the hypotenuse, and that's 761.577. 300 squared is 90,000. 3 times 3 is 9. A couple zeros and a couple zeros more when you square it, and you get 90,000. Plus x squared. Now, I did kind of work this one out to be as straightforward as possible here. 761.577 squared is 580,000 units, whatever, 580,000. We subtract both sides by 90,000, and we get x squared is equal to 490,000. Square root both sides, and we get x is equal to 700, the missing side of the right triangle. We're going to use basically the same diagram, but I'm going to move this, the x, to another location somewhere along this hypotenuse and see how much that changes our work. Bam! Waking you up. Now with this example, I've put the x and I've marked it off as just a portion of the hypotenuse. So we need to solve out what x is. We do know two sides of the right triangle, the radius of 35, the leg, and the other leg of 50, the length of this tangent, this sort of tangent segment. And we know the sort of the length of the hypotenuse. Now the length of the hypotenuse is not x, it's actually x plus this little segment here of 35. So the hypotenuse is actually x plus 35. Now, if I look at it that way and I go, okay, I got one leg which is 35, so 35 squared. I have another leg which is 50, so 50 squared equals a hypotenuse squared. Now the hypotenuse is x plus 35. And if I just look at that, boom, I see the hypotenuse as a binomial squared and start working it out. We have 35 squared, which is, referring to my notes here, 1225. 50 squared is 2500. And x plus 35 squared, x plus 35 times x plus 35 is going to be x squared plus 70x. I guess I should distribute this out. X squared plus 35x plus 35x plus, and 35 times 35 is, again, oh, it's right there, 225, or 1225. And that means that this is over here plus 1225. So x plus 35 squared is that trinomial, x squared plus 70x plus 1225. Well, I've got 1225 on both sides, so when I subtract that, from both sides of the equation, it's going to cancel out. And I need to do the same thing with the 2500, subtract that over to the other side as well, because, you know, it's positive too. So when we do that subtraction and get the 2500 from the left over to the right hand side, we're going to get 0 equals x squared plus 70x minus 2500. Now, when was the last time you tried to factor a trinomial with a constant that large? And as it turns out, this actually does not factor. So I would just look at this and straight away start doing the quadratic formula, which is going to be x equals negative 70 plus or minus the square root of 70 squared minus 4a C all over 2a. You know, when you have a quadratic equation that you can't factor or don't wish to try and factor, you can apply the quadratic formula to solve it instead, which again is the opposite of b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac over 2a. And when you have your degrees decreased, and we have a second degree, first degree, and then the constant, a is the coefficient, the leading coefficient, or the coefficient of the second degree term, b is the single degree term, and then c is the constant. When you work this out, you are going to get the answers of approximately 26 and negative 96. And because x is a length, you cannot use the negative value. Now, the way I've worked this out is really not the most efficient way, because we ended up being forced into using the quadratic formula because of how I label the hypotenuse as being, you know, x plus 35, and that is its length. If, however, I came through here and temporarily named the entire hypotenuse as value y, the problem numerically, as far as the process goes to solve it, or algebraically, becomes a lot simpler. It's going to be one leg squared, which is 35, plus the other leg squared, which is 50 squared, equals the hypotenuse squared, which is y squared. Now, see, I don't have any kind of binomial that I have to square that then forces me to work with a quadratic formula. How this is going to look, of course, is going to be 1225, that's 35 squared, plus 2500. I just don't want to try and do that in my head and end up making a mistake on these videos. I do that enough as it is every once in a while. 2500 and 1225 is 3725. I can square root both sides and get y squared is equal to approximately, I'm rounding this off a little bit, approximately 61. Now y is the entire length of the hypotenuse. X is only part of it. X is, you know, that entire hypotenuse with the 35 taken out. So I can now that I know the entire length is 61 units, approximately, I can say that, what color do I have it in? Blue. I can say that x is equal to 61, and it's again been rounded off. It's not rounded off very much, but approximately 61 minus this part of the hypotenuse, which is 35, and that is another way to get the answer of 26. Thinking about it, relabeling the problem a little bit, then working through it, and a little bit more thought ahead of time gave us what really was algebraically a simpler answer. I'm Mr. True. Those are a few more examples, a few more complicated examples of the Pythagorean theorem and how you use it to solve right triangles. Bam! Go do your homework.